good morning. We welcome all of you here in the room to Summit Springs Church and all of you online as well. We welcome you. Let's all stand together because we want to enter into a time of praise and worship to our Savior Jesus. Amen. Love, amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
The only voice I want to hear. walk with me and show me who you are as I draw near. If you're not in it, then I don't want it, and let all else fade away. Take the
something that our hearts really connect to. Sometimes it's easy to sing things. You know, I always think about that, Lord, oh, I'm singing to you, but am I really willing to do that? And it takes the grace of God. You know, it's not an easy thing just to say, Lord, if you're not in it, I don't want it, because it's a constant battle with our flesh to want things and desire things and want to fill our life with things that may not be the Lord. So for us to be able to submit ourselves to the Lord, it's not an easy walk, and you all know that, and I'm sure you struggle with it like I do. But let's start off today with just praying and saying, Lord, we really want that to be a reality in our lives, and help us, Lord, to do that. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you today. And Father, we've sang these songs to you that talk about walking with you, hearing from you, submitting to you. And Lord, we know that that's not an easy battle to win, but we want that. We want the victory in that. And we pray for your grace and your strength and the power and the presence of your Holy Spirit to come into our lives and enable us to say no to things that we know that are not of you, and to be able to say yes to the things that you're touching our heart with. And so, Lord, all the things of the world we know that are passing away, but your kingdom will endure forever. So we thank you for that. You've called us to be a part of your kingdom, your purposes, and your plans. And we submit ourselves to that today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's give him praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for your grace.
Well, let's take a minute and greet one another, and we will dismiss any elementary that's in here to go back to their class.
Good morning, everyone. There I am. It's so great to see you all this morning. In spite of virus and everything that's going on around this crazy world right now, it's such a blessing to be able to be in the house of the Lord and to be around our brothers and sisters in Christ. And I feel like I've kind of been out of it. I mean, we just missed one Sunday, and I'm like, what has happened to me? I miss my family. But it's been just a great time for the celebration that we had 2 weekends ago here for our 50th anniversary. And we just thank you guys so much for all your well wishes and gifts and blessings that we received. Thank you so much. It was just a wonderful time for us. And to have our family here that Sunday was so great from Colorado. And it was so funny because that's the first time some of the grandkids had ever been in our church. And my one grandson that's he's turning 9 today, he said, Mimi, I didn't know you played the piano like that. You're really good. I'm like, thank you. It was so sweet. Oh, gosh, that was awesome. So anyway, it's great to be back and just great to have you guys here. So if you're a first-time guest with us this morning, and by the way, some of you feel like it's first-time guests because you've been out because you've been ill or something, and we're really glad to have you back. It's good to see your faces. But if you have not filled out a family information sheet or our guest registration, we'd appreciate if you do that on the way out today, just so we have a record of your visit, and that helps us a lot to know who's here, and we enjoy getting to know you. It's always room for more new folks here. We love that. And this afternoon, right after service, is our youth meeting with Noah and Vic. So all of the kids that are 13 through 18, I think it is, 17, meet with Noah and Vic. If you don't know where to go, just check with Wanda at the guest counter out there after the service. We're reading through the book of Proverbs in January as a church, and that's just been such a blessing. Tom and I do that together in the mornings. So we've always had separate devotion times, but we've been doing that together and we talk about it. It's a great thing to do with your family because everything that's addressed in Proverbs is stuff we can all just totally connect to in your daily life. If you've been reading it, you get what I mean. You can never read Proverbs too many times. It's just been awesome. So we're doing that through the end of the month. And our men's Bible study is also meeting the Zoom study on Tuesday, Thursday mornings. If you'd like information on how to connect on that, Just email us at info@summitsringschurch.com and we'll let you know how to get connected. And once again, I just want to mention that family info sheet. This time of year when we have weather and sometimes things happen, we need important announcements to get out to the church family. And if we have your email, that's just really helpful. We'll get something in your box if there's something special going on, like we're not having service today, something like that, or we're just having an online service. It helps to keep us connected. And once again, we're just really glad to see everybody here. Oh, I know one more thing. We do have, especially at the first of the year, we just think about, you know, Lord, how can I be a more devoted follower of Jesus? And do you ever sense that you just really need change in your life? And the best way that we can do that is to be in the Word of God on a regular basis. And for me, I say this every year, but my reading through the Bible plan, it's not my plan, but it's one I use for 25 plus years, has just been such an amazing blessing to me, the change that's taken place in my life. And we just encourage you, find a way to be in the Word, and your life will change, and it'll be a blessing, such a blessing.
Is that right?
All right, thank you very much.
Do I have your endorsement?
You have my endorsement.
Okay, great.
Yeah, we're having a good time reading through the book of Proverbs together and discussing things together. I'm looking forward to the 31st where I can read Proverbs 31 and get her straightened out. No, she's a great wife. Great helpmate. I've said many times, I would not have made it in ministry any length of time, particularly not all the years that we've been in ministry, if it wasn't for her, because she is my undergirding administrative pastoral helper.
Bossy.
So, what was that?
Sometimes I'm kind of bossy.
Bossy, yeah. Sometimes, yeah, but sometimes I need that, you know. So, anyway. Well, it's good to see everyone. Pastor Howard, he filled in for me last week. He's a great guy, good friend of mine. We're just like, literally like brothers. We beat the heck out of each other all the time, verbally. And we've been friends, very close friends, for going on 40 years. And he told me to be sure and ask you, how many of you read the story of the prodigal son? Some of you committed to do that, and you did it. All right. I'll report back to him that that you all did that. I always appreciate it when he fills in for me, because I can trust him to teach the Word, you know, and that's so important, and that's what we're all about here. And we're not the fanciest church in town. We don't have all the high-tech smoke and lights and stuff, but one thing, when you come to Summit Springs, you'll get a Bible message, and you'll get encouraged to walk with the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And we'll continue trying to get better at the other things that we do. Glad to have Marcel and Celeste here and their family today. Their friends recently moved here from South Africa. Raise your hand there so everybody will know. You guys have settled in Blue Springs. Just a great couple. We've been connected with Marcel and his family off and on for 3 or 4 or 5 years now. And just great couple, great family. So glad to have them today. And the rest of you that are first-time guests with us today, or maybe you're a returning guest, thank you. Thank you for coming. I run into people every now and then that say that they've been watching us online and felt like maybe we were worth checking out personally. And, you know, we're kind of new in the online thing. You know, we just the last couple of years with COVID and upgraded our cameras and our internet and a bunch of stuff to try to do that a little bit better. I mean, several years ago, we were using a cell phone, and it would always be sideways, and we didn't have enough technical experience to know how to get the thing straightened out. And it was a mess, you know. But I don't have any technical skills, and Noah is our tech guy, and he's getting better all the time. And give Noah a hand. He helps us. And we're just trying to learn all this stuff. But for those of you that have been watching us online and maybe you decided to check us out, thanks for giving us that much of trust, and we'll be glad to get to know you. Well, we're going to be in the book of Joshua again today. I'm doing a series here for a while on, and I'm not sure how long it'll last. It's something that's really a dear part of my experience with the Lord, and I call it God Encounters. And I started years ago reading the Scripture, and the first few years I was a Christian, I focused on the New Testament. When I became a pastor, it dawned on me that it would be good if I knew what the whole Bible said, because I was going to have to teach on the long haul, you know, as a pastor every week. So I started studying the Old Testament, started studying Old Testament history, the development of the covenants, just everything from Genesis all the way through. And I've been amazed. I love the Old Testament. I love the New Testament. I love the whole Bible. But there's so many life stories and life encountering stories in the Old Testament that are dramatic, and they're a little different maybe than what we experience today in our culture. But the underlying principles that you see in those events are the same for us today. And that's what's so important about studying those things. And a couple of weeks, 3 or 4 weeks ago, we looked at Moses and Moses' encounter with God in the burning bush, and how Moses struggled with his identity, struggled with his past failures. He struggled with having the confidence to really believe that God would use him, you know. And he was a highly trained, very capable individual, but some setbacks in his life, you know, caused him to really lose confidence and lose heart. And we experience that. You know, I mean, we've all been through things where we think, wow, I don't know if I can recover from that. But you know, God's grace comes along, and God's forgiveness and God's empowerment, and the sun comes up again, and you start saying, okay, God, you know, I don't want to do that again, but we can go on. We can keep moving forward. And we all experience things like that. And then a couple of weeks ago, I talked about how important it was when God came to Joshua and said, I want you to take those memorial stones out of the bottom of the river. It's a supernatural crossing of the Jordan River on dry land, rolled the waters back, very similar to what happened to Moses and the children of Israel in crossing the Red Sea. And God said, take those stones out and make a pile so that in the generations to come, your kids, when they say, what do these stones mean? You'll be able to go back and tell them the story of how God dried up the Jordan River at flood stage and the children of Israel crossed on dry ground. And we need those. We need those memories. We need those events in our life, because they become milestones in our lives that we can be strengthened over and over again. And so I call them God encounters. I call them times when God, and the thing about God encounters that I see in Scripture is it's God's the one that, he's the one that sets them up. And a lot of times we're not looking for them, and we just happen to stumble into them. And that's the goodness of God, because God wants to meet with us, but we don't necessarily always we're not necessarily always on the same page at the same time with God. We're not necessarily seeking him in a major encounter, but yet, boom, there God is. And all of a sudden, God touches our heart, or God reveals himself to us, and he starts speaking to our heart about something maybe we're praying about, maybe we're fearful about, maybe we're in transition in an area of our life. And God uses those times oftentimes to meet with us. I've had several of those over the years. When I was in the military, there's a couple of different times when God encountered me in a very real way and a very dramatic way and changed the course of my life. And I look back on those, and I've had those in ministry. I've had dreams and visions where God has shown me things that have stuck with me over the years, over the decades, that I won't forget. That there are monumental things in my life that God has done. And that's what we see here in Joshua chapter 5. Turn with me to Joshua 5. Now, this is a kind of a continuation of the same historical time period that we looked at a week before last with the memorial stones. They've crossed the Jordan River. They're in the promised land now. They haven't yet fought their first battle. And God's already told them. He says, you're going to fight some battles, but I've already made the way, and you're gonna be victorious. So it's an interesting time. It's a transitionary time. Joshua's the new leader. He's got a new, younger generation of Hebrews that he's leading into the promised land, and they're going to learn some things. They're going to experience some important things. So as we pick up the text in verse 13, it says, "Now it came about when Joshua was by Jericho, He lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, a man was standing opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. All right, well, let's stop right there. That would catch most of our attentions. You know, if you were the leader and you knew that there was a battle that was going to ensue, you knew that the whole idea of going into the promised land was pretty scary for the Hebrews, because they knew they were going in, they were coming out of years in the wilderness where there was basically nothing, into an established territory that had some very strong, warlike, well-seasoned, well-trained Canaanite tribes, and they lived in walled cities. They weren't nomadic people. They weren't just tribes wandering around the desert. These were well-established cities with walls. They say the walls of Jericho may have been as much as 18 feet thick. Some pictures show them in two stages, where you have a first wall, an embankment, and then another wall. And by the time you get up to the top wall, it's 40, 50 feet in the air. And so the idea of primitive soldiers coming out of the wilderness, being able to conquer a city like that was a very daunting, very, very sobering experience. And so here's Joshua coming into the promised land, haven't fought a battle yet, knowing that the first battle is this massive city called Jericho. And they're standing there, or they're camping there in that region, and he has this encounter with this man that he doesn't know, he doesn't recognize. It says the man was standing opposite him with the sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said to him, "Are you for us or for our adversaries?" And he said, "No," which is always a very encouraging answer, no, you know. I mean, no what? You know, no, yes, no, no. Are you for us? No. Are you for our enemy? No, no. And so he didn't get much out of that answer. He just said no. He said, "Rather, indeed, I come now as the captain of the host of the Lord." And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and bowed down and said to him, "What is my Lord to say to his servant?" And he'll go on here in a minute, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that. But what we see here is so significant, because it shows us a little bit more about how God works on the earth and how God works in our life. First of all, he asks a question that probably most of us would ask. If you were getting ready to go into battle and you saw a person standing there armed and with a sword in his hand, you would probably want to know, is he here to fight with you on your side? Or is he here as a scout from the city of Jericho out there observing what is going on, getting ready to report back to the armies in Jericho? He didn't know, you know, so he's asking an honest question. And it's interesting because, you know, we want God to be on our side. Right? I mean, is there anybody in here that doesn't want God to be on your side? If you're fighting a battle, if something's going on in your life, isn't it great when God's on our side? How many are praying for the Chiefs this afternoon that God will make them win the game? I'm sure there's people in Buffalo praying that their team will win. So what's God to do? You know, is God on their side too? Whose side's God on in this game this afternoon? Well, once again, you know, we have to know God. We have to understand what God is really about and what he's doing in the earth to be able to answer those kind of questions. So does God take sides? Does God take sides? Is God a Republican? Is God a Democrat? Is God a socialist? Is God a communist? What is God? Well, he's none. None of the above. And so when you look at the scripture, I wish God was a Republican. I mean, you know, I'm a Republican. I've been a Republican all my life. I mean, I would like to think that God's a Republican. But he doesn't take sides. Why doesn't God take sides? Because God is bigger than that, for one thing. The Bible says in Genesis 18 that basically Abraham asked in a similar question. As God was getting ready to go down to Sodom and Gomorrah to rain judgment on that city for their gross immorality, the Bible says, Abraham was interceding for God. And he says, far be it from you to slay the righteous with the wicked. He says, will not the judge of all the earth do what is right? And see, that's what we have to understand about God. God is going to do what is right. God is always going to resist evil and support righteousness. He is always going to fight against unrighteousness, and he's always going to stand with the righteous. Now, there's times when it may not look like he's standing with the righteous. It may look like we're going through some very challenging, very difficult times. But see, God has a plan that supersedes everything that goes on the earth. And it's called his eternal kingdom. When Daniel saw the vision in Daniel chapter 2 of the stone cut out of the mountain without hands, and it says that this stone really ground to powder every earthly kingdom, but yet this stone would develop into a kingdom that would last forever, he's talking about the kingdom of God. And he's talking about the purposes of God on this earth, the purposes of God in our lives. So we as covenant people with God, as kingdom people with God, we don't ask God, God, are you on our side? The question that we have to ask is, God, am I on your side? Am I about your purposes, your righteousness, and your kingdom? Is that what I'm about? Is that what my heart burns for? Is my heart long for the fulfillment of your kingdom and your glory and your purposes on the earth, even when it may not be what I really think I want? And see, that's what Joshua is dealing with here. He's trying to figure out, okay, who is this person? Who are they going to fight for? And he encounters God, and that's why God says, answers this question in this way. I would much rather God say, well, sure, I'm on your side. We're going to go over there and we're going to knock down those walls. But he didn't say that. He said, no. He said, indeed, I'm come as the captain of the host of the Lord. I don't know about you, but every time I read that, I just send something through me, an awe. A fear, a respect, a fear in the good way. A lot of people don't like to talk about fear, but you know, that's one of the problems with modern day Christianity is we've lost the fear of the Lord. But you know, when we encounter God, there's something about that encounter that really, really is unique. And you see it here. Moses experienced the very same thing. He says, Joshua fell on his face to the earth and bowed down and said to him, what is my Lord to say to his servant? Now, you would think at this point, the servant of the Lord, the captain, who most scholars believe is a pre-incarnate appearance of Jesus Christ, that he would start to lay out the battle plan, but that's not what he says. He says, remove your sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy. And Joshua did so. Now, there's no doubt that this is an encounter with God and not an angel. Angels never allow worship. They never command worship. They always communicate the message that God sends through them in a very direct way, but not in a way of you fall down and worship the angel. This is a divine encounter with the living God. This is very similar to the burning bush experience. And he says, I am the captain of the host of the Lord. That means he is the King of glory. He is the one who leads the armies of heaven. You go to Revelation chapter 19 and 20, and you see this person coming back at the end of the age, arrayed in glory, riding on a white horse with the armies of heaven, the host of heaven behind him. It's the same captain. It's our Lord Jesus Christ. And so you see this encounter, and it's just an amazing encounter because God is encountering Joshua not to just to encourage him and just to give him a battle plan, which he'll do in a few minutes, but to reveal God's eternal plans and purposes. When we have an encounter with God, it's not just to make us feel good. It's not just to encourage us, although it may, but it's to reveal a portion of God's eternal plan that He wants us to link up and to be a part of. One of the first encounters I had, a personal encounter with God in a very real and very strong way, was when God called me to ministry. I was seeking God, praying for direction. I was about to get out of the military, and I needed direction. I said, Lord, do you want me to just go back into civilian life and get a job, or do you want... I'd already been functioning in ministry and had a heart for ministry, but I didn't know. I didn't have that specific calling. God met with me in a very unique way one night when I was on board ship and actually off the coast of East Africa, sitting there anchored out, waiting. And so it's an interesting encounter I had with God. And I've had several encounters like that since then. One time we were in between ministry. I'd been a youth pastor and graduated from Bible college and was out of ministry for a while and was really seeking God about the next step, the next place of ministry. And I had a friend in Illinois who was a pastor and knew of an open church in the denomination that I was a part of then in Illinois. And so we went over to Illinois to try out for this church, and God didn't tell me to go to Illinois. God had actually told me to stay in Blue Springs, but I was determined, because there was no church ministry position in Blue Springs, I was determined to go check out this church in Illinois and find out if that's where God wanted us. So we got all the way over to Illinois, drove over in the wintertime in a snowstorm, and... got there, little country church in a little small town in southern Illinois, and had a fellowship dinner with all the leaders and the deacons at night on a Saturday night. Went back to our motel, and I was going to get up and preach the next Sunday, and they were going to vote on us to see if they wanted us to be the pastors. Well, that night, after this church dinner, I got sicker than I think I had ever been, throwing up. You know, whether I got food poisoning or whether God just let me be sick. All night I was in the toilet, literally. And about 4 in the morning I was crying out to God. I says, God, heal me. I've got to get well so I can preach the next morning. And God met me in the toilet. Now this is a real interesting story. As I was in the toilet, literally, with my head, God spoke to me. I'm praying in the toilet. And God spoke to me and says, I didn't tell you to come to Illinois. I told you to stay in Blue Springs and wait until I brought to pass what I called you there for. I said, okay, God. All right. And it's interesting. It doesn't make any sense to me, but God told me to eat an apple. So we had an apple in the room. I ate an apple, and that was the first thing I was able to hold down and not throw up for many, many hours. And I don't know what the significance of eating an apple was, except God told me to eat an apple. So, but the thing was, while I was in the toilet, I had to submit to God and say, okay, God, I will not go to that church the next morning. I will not speak. I will head back to Blue Springs as fast as I can. And that's what we did. And I never tried out for a church again. To this day, I've never tried out for a church. So I have had some encounters that are unique, kind of weird, you know. I mean, who would have ever dreamed that God would meet you in the bowl of a toilet? But He did, you know, and it's one of the most significant encounters I've had with God. And God was, in a sense, disciplining me, and He was directing me. He was bringing revelation about and confirmation about what He had already told me, because I knew when I came to Blue Springs in 1976, I knew that God had called me here to this city. Now, a lot of people that go into ministry, they just kind of go around, bounce around different cities, different states, wherever there's an open church. I mean, that's common, you know, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that, but God specifically called me to Blue Springs. And every time I tried to leave, God would shut the door. even up until the last 6 years, you know, I thought, well, Lord, am I done here? Because I had a gap in ministry, and I said, am I done here, Lord? Can we move to another part of the country? I don't know if she was, but my kids live in Colorado. I was thinking, well, Lord, I wouldn't mind living in Colorado, you know. And Lord, I would really love to live in Florida where it's warm. You know, I'm thinking of all these places if the Lord would let me move, you know, but God wouldn't let me move. So once again, you know, God says, you're not done here. And we started this church in 2016. And so, you know, but I've had those kind of encounters, some of them very dramatic, some of them more, a little bit more passive. But that's the way God works. He wants to encounter us. He wants to meet with us to bring us into a place of alignment with His purposes. You know, it's not just for fun and games. It's not just for thrills. It's for adjustments. It's for course modifications. It's for confirmation sometimes. And so Joshua's in this place here where, you know, he needs to know what to do. He's a new leader. He's young in respect to what Moses was, and he needs to know what God's plan is. And so the next question is who's leading this thing? Who is really leading our lives and what we do? Is it us or is it the Lord? Well, that's the reason why he identifies himself here as the captain of the host of the Lord. And the opportunity is for Joshua to submit to this heavenly being that he's encountered. And that's why Joshua fell on his face and bowed down. It was an act of humility. It's a realization that the one that you've encountered is more important and more powerful than you are. And you do that by humbling yourself before him. And then we look at, okay, whose plans are they for the battle? Are we going to do our thing, or are we going to find out what God wants and find out how God wants us to pursue the next season of our life? Now, I think Joshua probably was starting to work up a plan for the battle to fight against Jericho, because Joshua was a seasoned warrior. There's no doubt about that. They crossed the Jordan River. There was Jericho. It was probably a little distance away. They could see it on the horizon. He was probably already trying to come up with a plan to deal with Jericho. Now, in ancient warfare, I'm sure you all have read this and read stories or seen movies about this, about the only way to attack a strong, fortified, walled city was with a siege. And what they would do is the army would surround the city. They would cut off their water supply. They would try to cut off their food supply. Most of these walled cities had extensive storerooms for food and water, and it would take a long time. And some history tells us that when the Jews fled to Petra in 70 AD, that it took 3.5 years for the Roman army to besiege Petra and to break through and to finally get to that place. And so these siege warfare type things sometimes were very difficult. The Hebrews weren't advanced enough to have catapults and different things that were a part of ancient warfare with some of the more defined armies. So, you know, they were pretty much going to have to just surround that thing try to figure out a way to scale the walls, and that would have been very costly for them to do. So, but Joshua, no doubt, is thinking, okay, how are we going to do this? How are we going to fight this battle? How are we going to get those walls over the walls and destroy what's on the inside of the city? And so, but God had a plan. And if Joshua had not had the encounter with this heavenly being, this captain of the host of the Lord, he would not have had a very good plan to fight this battle. And, you know, that comes back to us. How many times have you stepped out to do something and you thought your plan was the best thing on earth? Any of you ever done that? Think, well, this is going to work. Well, no, it's not going to work. Any of you ever wore yourself out trying to make it work and it didn't work? But yet when God reveals himself to us and God speaks to us, all of a sudden we have divine revelation. I'm going to tell you something. An ounce of divine revelation is worth a ton of human wisdom. Actually worth a lot more than a ton of human wisdom. And see, that's what the enemy wants us to do. The enemy wants us to get into our mind and our realm of thinking, oftentimes based on our limitations, based on our past experiences, based on what we think we're good at, and sometimes we miss God's best plan. And so it's an amazing thing trying to walk this out in our lives. And sometimes we blow it, you know. I've had times when I've blown it. I've come up with some really cool plans that I thought, man, God, you're going to love this. And I have literally beaten myself in the head with my own plans, trying to make them work, and ended up, in some cases, I think for years, struggling with the ramifications of my plans. I won't go into detail on what they were, but as a senior pastor, you can imagine I've had plans for all kinds of things, and hired the wrong people and tried to make people fit a need that we had that just, you know. And my wife, in all of her wisdom, would tell me before I did it, that's not the right one. And I think, yeah, it is. Yeah, we can make it work. And I've always had a problem listening to her. I don't know about you guys. Do any of you guys readily, easily, eagerly listen to your wives? All right. Praise God. See, you've been down the road. But you know, most of us guys are just a little bit stubborn, a little bit hard-headed, a little bit too proud to take advice from our wife. So then sometimes God uses them to try to spare us pain and suffering, and we don't see it, so we have pain and suffering. And so, but I've, over the years, and I'm getting pretty old. If I don't learn this pretty quick, there's not much hope for me. And, you know, I'm just telling you, some of you younger guys, get ahead of me. I mean, you know, get ahead of the game here, because it took me a long time to learn that God might be speaking through my wife. So Joshua is in this situation where I think he has a plan. I really do. I think he thinks he's going to take the army and he's going to go out there and he's going to surround this city and he's going to maybe try to figure out how to scale those walls. And I think that probably would have cost him a lot of troops and probably been very difficult. They may have eventually been able to do it, but it would have been very difficult. And so God has another plan. And so God starts speaking to Joshua specifically then in Joshua 6. And he says, now Jericho was shut up tight because of the sons of Israel. No one went in or out. And the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand. Now this is a faith statement. Now God doesn't have to struggle to make faith statements. You understand that? God makes statements because he knows what's going to happen. But for us, we hear it and we have to say, okay, do I have faith to believe that God just told me what he told me? God says, look what he said. He says, see, he's talking to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand. Now look, the walls are still there. The people are inside. Nothing has changed. Except God has spoken a word over the battle, a prophetic word over the battle. And we have to decide when we hear that prophetic word from the Lord. Do we believe that that was from God? Do we believe that God actually said that? Is God actually going to give us? He said it's already done. Notice what he says. He says, I have given. That's past tense. That's not, he didn't say, I will give. You guys go out there and get your tail beat for a while, and then eventually I'm going to give you the victory. That's not what he said. He said, I have given you Jericho, I've given Jericho into your hand with its king and valiant warriors. You shall march around the city, all the men of war circling the city once. You shall do for 6 days. Also, the seven priests shall carry the seven trumpets of ram's horns before the ark, and on the seventh day you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow the trumpets. And then he says, and it shall be that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of that city will fall down flat, and the people will go in, every man straight ahead. And it's just amazing how that battle plan. Now, nobody would come up with that battle plan. None of us would look at that and say, well, that's what we're going to do. You know, we're going to march around the city and blow a bunch of trumpets. And then we're going to yell really loud. And these 40-foot high walls are going to fall down flat. Now, some archaeologists believe that they actually fell down into the earth. It's like the earth opened and they fell down flat. Because if you take a wall that's 18 feet thick and it falls over, you still got to climb over it a long ways to get into it. And it says they went straight in. Every man went straight in. So the picture almost, the description almost sounds like the walls literally collapsed into the earth. And whether that's what happened or not, they won the battle. I mean, that's what God did. Now notice what Scripture says, and if you've been reading Proverbs with me this week, you've read this passage. It says in Proverbs 19, many are the plans of a man's heart, but the counsel of the Lord will stand. See, that's the contrast that every single one of us comes to time and time again in our lives. Many are the plans of our heart. I have tons of plans. I have all kinds of things I want to do. But I've got to be careful and not launch out and do what I want to do if the Lord isn't in it, if the Lord's not giving me the counsel and the go-ahead to do it. Because the counsel of the Lord will stand. So the idea there behind that verse is the plans of man will evaporate, but the word of the Lord will stand forever. Heaven and earth will pass away, the Bible says, but God says, my word will always be there. My word will endure forever. And so we know that God is always trying to bring us, his children, into line to work with him rather than us trying to bring God into our life and work with us. And see, that's a subtle difference sometimes, and we got to really pray and be honest with ourselves to be able to sort that difference out sometimes, because a lot of times our good ideas, man, they seem great. I've done them. I could sit down with you in private and tell you, I won't say it publicly, but I could tell you a lot of plans that I thought, man, these are good plans. And really, really wasted a lot of time trying to make them come to pass. So when God's moving and when we're moving with God, we're going to have the victory. When God is leading the battle, when God is laying the battle plan, and God is the one who is leading the host of the armies of the Lord, then truly we can say, like he says to Joshua here, see, I've given Jericho into your hands. I've given the problem you're having at work into your hands. I've given the problem you're having with your finances. I've given the problem you're having with your children, with your kids, with your spouse, whatever the case may be, I've given them into your hands because I have a plan and I have a way to glorify myself and my kingdom, and you can participate with me. And so that's the thing that God is doing on the earth. So no, God is not necessarily for us or for our adversaries. He's not necessarily for America over some other country. I mean, I will say this, God will always stand on the side of righteousness. We have to understand that. He'll always stand on the side of righteousness. But even in the history of Israel, there was times when God gave them over to pagan nations to be overrun, their cities destroyed, and carried off to captivity. Why? Because they were living unrighteously and refusing to acknowledge the Lord. They had turned to idols, they had turned to paganism, they had basically just turned their back on God. And God said, I'm going to stand with righteousness. And if it takes the Babylonians to wake us up, to bring us into a place again of renewed righteousness, then God will allow the Babylonians to overrun our cities. Which really, in a great example, probably is what's happening to America right now. The pagans are overrunning our cities. The pagans are controlling our government. And what we can do is to humble ourselves before God and say, God, I want your kingdom, your glory, your purposes in my life, in my family, in my business, in my home, every single part of my life. I want your plan, your purposes, and your kingdom to be glorified. Amen? Yes. Amen? And God encounters in our life cause us to realize, okay, it's like a portal. It's like God opens up a portal into his kingdom, into his presence, and we can see what God is wanting to do. And it readjusts and refocuses and recalibrates our lives. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace. Even when we don't desire to encounter you, sometimes you break through anyway. And Lord, when times like that come, I pray that you'll help us to be humble, submissive, to be clay in your hands so that we can truly be molded and shaped into the covenant people that you want us to continue to be. So Lord, I pray in Jesus' name right now, if there's anybody here in this room that is outside of Christ, outside of relationship with you, Lord, for whatever reason, they've either fallen away, grown cold, or they've never known you. I pray that you would encounter them right now. Touch their hearts. Bring revelation of your love and your grace. If you don't know Jesus Christ, he loves you. He died for you. He shed his blood for you. He wants you to come into relationship with him. He wants you to walk with him and to minister with him and to work with him, to live life with him. And he offers you an open door. He says, if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and I will relate to him. I will eat with him. I will live life with him. So, Father, I pray that in Jesus' name. We receive you by receiving your completed work on the cross, believing that your shed blood has totally covered, erased, and washed away our sins. You've forgiven us because of your shed blood if we receive you as Lord and Savior. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. If anybody wants prayer, anybody has any questions about what it means to come to the Lord, if you've had a divine encounter that you're trying to sort out and you want someone just to pray with you, I'd be glad to talk to you and pray with you. God's a good God. He loves you. He has a plan and a purpose for your life. Thank you, Jesus.
Jesus, look full in his word.
Let's give him praise. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Well, you guys go in peace. Have a wonderful week.